move on to the general case of dot product, where we take the dot product of two vectors of size n each. And if you write it out, then the exact result would require the given multiplications and additions. And we're going to assume that the additions happen from left to right. Order obviously matters. So now what's happening here is that when we compute kappa check, these multiplications will happen first, and you can think of it as this multiplication happens, then this multiplication happens, then this addition happens, then the next multiplication happens, then the next addition happens, and so forth, right? So eventually you get a dot, dot, dot like this. All right. Now, how does that mean? How do these epsilons come in that come from the standard computation model? Well, it means that when we do this first multiplication, we incur an error. When we do the second multiplication, we incur an error. When we do this addition, we incur an error. When we do the next multiplication, we incur an error. When we perform this this addition, we incur an error. And so forth. Now let's distribute all of these 1 plus epsilons that come along. And if you do that, what you get is that the first term is hit by 1 plus epsilon star 0. And then this one right here, 1 plus epsilon plus 1. And then 1 plus epsilon plus 2. And so forth, all the way down to 1 plus epsilon plus n minus 1. Okay. And if you look at the second term is hit by 1 plus epsilon star 1. And then the same sequence here, 1 plus epsilon plus 1, and so forth. If you go to the next term, oops, these should be pluses, you get 1 plus epsilon star 2, but that one is not hit by this 1 plus epsilon, only by the rest of them. So if we have 1 plus epsilon plus 2 here, just to make this clear, we get 1 plus epsilon plus 2 here, and so forth. Okay, and the way to kind of think about this is that this first term is hit by errors n times. The second term is hit by errors n times. The third term is hit by errors n minus 1 times. The next one by n minus 2 times, and so forth. Okay, now this right here, if you work it all out, actually looks like 1 plus epsilon star 0 plus epsilon plus 1 plus and so forth. And then you get a term that has two of these epsilons multiplied together in all combinations and so forth. Now, each of these epsilons in magnitude is less than the machine epsilon. So these further terms where you start multiplying multiple epsilons together become very small in a hurry. Okay, the additional of all of these terms would be order the machine epsilon squared and so forth. So you kind of see that, roughly speaking, this first term ends up being equal to 1 plus some epsilon where that epsilon in absolute value is less than or equal to n times the machine epsilon, I can't write it there, plus some very small stuff. Okay? Still, this is really cumbersome, right? Wouldn't it be nice if we had a nice clean notation for capturing that this term has been hit by n errors? Okay? And for that, we introduced the notation 1 plus theta sub n, where that 1 plus theta sub n is supposed to capture all of this right here, except that, you know, in different circumstances, the epsilon would be somewhat different. And therefore, this theta n really captures the number of errors that have been accumulated in a term, as opposed to it being an actual value. So you will run into different instances of theta n that actually represent slightly different values. And you should always interpret 1 plus theta n as order of magnitude. Okay, when you see theta n, you say, ah, this term has been hit by error n times. And that's going to clean everything up for us.